We'll wait and see, honestly, and how they're going to lay this up, how they're going to do this. You know, I wouldn't be shocked to see Elden play Venge Core. Now that you've put it into my mind, it's almost certainly going to happen. But let's say he does go Venge Carry. What is the proper build, especially with all the new items now out and available and eligible?
Definitely Dragonlance, because it enhances your weak range and gives you very good stats. You can go Helm of the Dominator. That was the way that Illidan would always play in the past. That way you get a neutral, like a Alpha Wolf or something. That way you get two damage ores. That's pretty good to do. This game looks like a BKB game to me. But, you know, it might not be Carry Venge, but I think Dragonlance minimum is very strong, and you can transition to. So it's probably core Alk here.
Yeah, I would imagine. Probably in the mid lane.
Good game for Alk. If he gets Aghanims, by the way. Mm-hmm. Really good.
Ags, this game, good on any one of these heroes. Oracle with his Purifying Flames being even faster, off cooldown, Vengeful Spirit having the extra illusion, which is actually amazing in terms of the damage and utility that it can provide. Not to mention swapping creeps, also is still
pretty good. That A pick, though.
Yeah, that's a great
just completely kind of counters what Elk wants to do. It's pretty good against Oracle also. Yeah. So they kind of got screwed here a bit. But as long as Alchemist doesn't get hit by the A ultimate, he's still very strong. A also makes their tri lane very strong, so even if Fantastic Five do something like a Sand King Oracle Venge tri lane, they should be better off against playing against it just because of Chilling Touch. But we'll see. There's gonna be a lot of shit going on early, and that's for sure.
I mean, we saw Bloodbath early game last game. It was pretty fun to watch. I'm hoping for roughly the same in this game. Well, that remains to be seen, but we have 1 minute left on reserve time for Team Empire. The last band's coming out now here for this first game of this best of three series. Like you mentioned, the AA last pick coming out for Empire, a bit interesting, allowing with the Chilling Touch to provide them even more damage. They have plenty of match damage already throughout this game. They'll have Mirana Ags as well if they do decide to pick that up as a core, which is, you know, with the Kunkka and Ancient Apparition, I would imagine those are the two supports. Then Nyxus has an off lane and then Mirana core. However, any one of these heroes can be run as support, slash Kunkka can be run as a core, Nyxus Ass can be put in the off lane. So there's lots of thoughts.
Alchemist support, maybe? You going to go so far?
Not for that, no. Fantastic Five.
Just trying to trick you, that's all mine.
Are trying to get in my head.
They got two stuns right now, not counting Elk's stun. Anti-Mage is going to be a pretty big pain in the ass, especially because they're pretty magic damage heavy. Although, in their defense, they have two minus armor sources right now, so they have some decent ways to deal with Anti-Mage, but I think I like Empire's draft a lot better right now. I feel like the A really, like, cuts things apart in terms of the Elk being a strong core, and with, like, Nyx Assassin and Kunkarum, I feel like the nuke heavy damage from Fantastic Five's roster is going to be iffy.
I'm not sold, especially with this Spearbreaker pick. I feel like, yeah, these heroes have survivability, but if they get caught with some disables, they're going to dive rather quickly is the one thing I'm kind of concerned about for Empire.
Yeah, that's why the SP pick was pretty good. They can always initiate with it, even pre-Blink Dagger on Sand King. So Spearbreaker followed up with Sand King stun, followed up with Venge stun, and a Wave of Terror. Like, that's a dead hero. Even Anti-Mage is going to have a lot of trouble with that once their skill points get maxed out. Like, that's 6 seconds of disable, and Anti-Mage won't be able to evade it as easily as normal.
It's tough, I think, for the AA in this game, even with the charge and all of that jazz. There are plenty of disables. There's a lot of ways to lock down a lot of these heroes. Despite the Ancient Apparition pick, which I totally agree with you, by the way, and that pick being very good, especially for fighting early and dealing with the Alchemist, I think Fantastic Five have ways to deal with it. They had ways to deal with the escape lineups last game, and in fact, in both of the games, in games 1 and 2, but they were just a little bit too far away in terms of... They just missed out on a lot of these kills, so it's something that you're going to have to keep an eye out for. As we do jump into the game, the smoke came out for Empire. They will spot out the fact that Always Would a Fly is in the jungle. He's not placed down a ward, he's actually just came to scout this out. Kingar has a ward on him. And Always Want to Fly with early caustic finale. There he goes. Slow him down. But actually, he won't chase him behind the tower. He wouldn't have gotten that kill, but does a nice bit of damage there nonetheless.
Yeah, that was pretty good. He also didn't place a ward down. He just actually was scouting, so he should have better control over his lane. Probably just trying to help out Yol a little bit on the Spearbreaker.
Yeah.
Isn't that Yoki or Yoku or whatever, right?
Y-O-L? I think Yol's a completely different player.
Okay. Felt like he was one of those guys that has a different tag to how you pronounce his name. At least in my
that's opinion. A possibility, but I'm 80% sure that Yul's a different player than Yoku. I'm going to go ahead and say that with confidence.
All right.
Good word place, by the way.
I'm bad at my job.
The Radiant team.
Ooh, the double mango Nyx assassin. He's hungry for fruit.
He's,
And HP regen.
And, yeah, he's got a lot of that because guess what? His base HP regen is like 3.2.
All right, they're going to contest this bounty. Oh, man, everybody's here on Empire. This is so bad for El.
Yeah, I think you need to leave and head towards bottom. But the problem is that Anti-Mage is bottom. They actually are going to get both rally runes. Okay, for free.
Yo, that's a huge mistake from F5 there. You have to be aware of that shit and take care of it. Because now he's got Grievous Greed level 1, which means, you know, if he had Acid Spray, at least he could Acid Spray the Creep Wave, kill it, get level 2. But now he's just not even off to a good start.
And he's going up against Brana, who has decent range. Obviously, again, her right click is a little bit low, but it's doable. If Undershot can pull this Creep Wave back, or they get a Torrent, that works too. Yeah, I mean, this is already a great start for this mid lane, and we'll keep our eyes there as we progress through the game.
Yeah, it was really all about getting the range creep there. The range creep really starts your lane off in a good way, in terms of experience advantage.
Yul's chasing down Afterlife. Bash level 1, so there's always that possibility they get the Bash and they try to go for the kill, but with two heroes down there instead of the three, it's going to be tough to try to secure an early game pickup because they do have Arm and just working top to help. Again, Illidan on that safe lane, Vengeful Spirit, by the way, farm up and get his early items.
It's kind of cool to see carry Venge in some ways. Like, he basically gets to cast Wave of Terror on the offlane while the support tries to zone. So, despite him farming, he can actually contribute a lot more than a carry normally would. It's kind of cool.
Makes Oracle a little bit better. That. I always forget about Wave early on for a carry Venge. In fact, I don't see enough carry Venge to really, you know, notice it. Meanwhile, always want to fly bottom lane. He'll salve up and avoid actually dying. However, it's going to be canceled by King R, so he might have to make the long trip back home. But still, a lot of aggression putting out from Empire early on in this tri lane. And they need to find some kills and extra experience. King R is going to go ahead and rotate and look for Always Wanna Fly, but with no more chilling touch-up, he can't quite get that kill as the Tango is regenning up the sinking as well. But that'll be the end of the engagement at that bottom lane for now.
All right, Mod, it's time for the most balanced part of the game. Will Alchemist get a bounty rune?
Well, that's the question, isn't it? And will he be able to actually get one? His Undershock is going to take the top rune spot. Bottom is going to be taken by Mposhka. So, yeah, he's not getting a rune regardless.
Rest in peace, Alchemist.
I mean, Empire gets
last hits, but
they not only get the 0-minute bounty runes, they also get the 2-minute bounty rune as well as an invis rune for Undershock, who is probably just going to waste it and just try to see us under the tower, which I do not blame him for.
It's a pretty big deal. Isn't 633 BZZ, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I thought. I just realized that now.
Afterlife is going and going to last hit under the tower as the pulse coming through. Always Wanna Fly wants to contest this, rightfully so, but might not have such luck in doing so as there's going to be some good denies from DR. He also has Chilling Touch ready to go. Level 1 still, good Torrent should be right on top of Always Wanna Fly, and it is, and it'll slow him down, but I don't think they have the damage to kill him. Even with the Chilling Touch, they would need an X Mark, which they do have, but with level
what?
1
they
X Marks,
killed him,
I don't know, it's going to be close, I think. Oh, they can definitely kill now. That Sitzer Conqueror's top was beautiful. And now X Marks will go. Good Burrow Strike, but it will not save his life. There's the Chilling Touch coming out. It's first blood for Afterlife on the Anti-Mage. And perfectly so.
It's just so strong. Chilling Touch with Kunkka, man. How do you beat that? Like, you guarantee that you get so many free right clicks in, and it does 150 magic damage for up to 3 heroes. Yes, it reduces their attack speed slightly, but now that's going to reduce to, like, what, 120 or something like that? It's an insane amount of damage.
It is. And to hit that Torrent, knowing that the Centaur Conqueror would stop, or just guessing even, it's beautifully done. Intended
Wait,
or not.
Stomped by the Centaur?
Yeah, they got stomped by the Centaur, then they set up for the Torrent right after that. It was actually gross. I'm lucky to have caught it. I thought they weren't going to be able to get the kill. But there's a charge coming in as Yul is down here now. Burst Strike is missed completely. Torrent going to hit up, and here they go again. They've got the Chilling Touch up, and they've got now, I think, what should be enough damage for the X-Marks. They'll bring him back, and it's another kill. This time picked up by Mposhka, as he'll hit level 3. This tri lane down bottom is successful. This dual lane coming out for F5, not really at all.
Yeah, it's amazing how this A pick just wrecked everything for F5 this game. It's going to make the Alchemist weaker. They easily got both bounty, got both runes at the start, so Alchemist didn't even get a good gold start. And it just wrecks Trilanes as well with Chilling Touch. It's such a good pick in this game, and it's really showing its value. I mean, maybe F5 is misplaying that. Obviously, they missed the Burrow, and maybe they wouldn't even have gotten the kill otherwise. But either way, that pick is really doing a lot there for Empire.
The good news for F5 is that the Alchemist has done rather well for himself. Again, If the CS in this lane is even, then the Alchemist is winning, at least because he has the Grievous Greed to work with. He didn't get the Bounty Runes, and that's the one thing that might come back to haunt him. They also have a ward to get vision of him stacking or heading to the jungle, so something also to keep in mind. Top lane, they also have the Venge free farming up to the top in CS, and Ghostick is coming for a charge as well. Yeah. But I think that this is, regardless, still a pretty good start for Empire. We'll see if they can get
definitely kill him here. Ghosting. It all comes down to when he spike carapaces. I think Illidan's got a stun as the stun comes in.
There it is. Oh, spike carapace, perfectly timed. Dodges all that damage from the magic missile, which he did level up, but still purifying flames now, healing him up. It's not going to be enough, the Moonlight Shadow, and Illidan will hit the tower trying to take the aggro off of Yul and Armin, but actually it was unsuccessful. Torrent on two. Armin is low. Can they get this kill? It looks like absolutely. Maybe not. Liv Tear comes out. Mipashka, Fortune's End. They bring down Spiritbreaker, but it's the neutrals that kill him. Torrent dodged by Illidan, and Miposhka's low as well. And Illidan bodyguarding, zoning everybody out into great Fortune's End to keep him in place. I thought Mipashka would have gotten that kill almost certainly, but was unlucky to a certain extent as he's going to deny himself real quick.
It's a really hard gank to execute there. I think the only way they would have made that work is if they didn't scare the Nyx back, so that when the SV charge came through and used Spiked Carapace, he could hold the stun until afterwards. But because the stun damage was stopped, it messed everything up.
Mm-hmm. I mean, he's maxing out the Vengeful Spirit stun, so it's really important that you get that damage off.
And they just wouldn't be able to burst him otherwise.
So with no mana and, plenty of CS, he'll just go back to doing said CSing. Always want to fly his rotated back down bottom. And two deaths to his name, 19 last hits. Could be a lot worse, could be a lot better for this Sand King, but...
this is going to be an easy kill.
Miposhka is a little too far in the jungle and will almost certainly fall here. No way. That torrent can't save his life. Oh my god, he's actually going to live. Oh my lord. Undershock also helps out as well. What a torrent. Miposhka is putting on a clinic with these torrents. It's insane. Not only that, he's losing experience while he's at it. Oh, this guy.
That was the easiest kill I've ever seen, and then he actually got out. That was insane, man. Maybe Armin messed up with his nukes or something. Like, maybe he should have nuked twice, then do Fortune's End or something, but what an insane play.
And Kuka denies himself again. And as you said, more space created here. As Empire will have their Anti-Mage Afterlife continue to farm up with now Treads and a Ring of Health done on top of his PMS and Qualling Blade. Nyx Assassin will find a kill top lane. Illidan actually gets killed by Ghostic solo with Vendetta, which is not something I was expecting, and thus I missed it. But now he's getting charged up. There's the Spike Carapace. They get the Torrent. They're going to turn. The Impale Ghostic is not done yet. Miposhka here again. He's seeming to be all over the map. This Miposhka Kunkka is delivering.
They're just absolutely stomping. But you know, one really bad thing about that for Empire, though, is that Nyx Assassin is going to get really hungry soon because that was his last mango.
Oh, no. But he's got Arcane Boots, though. I mean, it's not quite the same food as a mango.
Yeah, and he did solo kill the enemy carry. That's a pretty good thing. I really like he's saving his stun here. Easy nuke. This should kill Ghostick.
Yes, finally they will bring him down. And Miposhka can only try to help out with an X marks at a torrent in that fact, but... Still, though.
Yeah, that's how they have to do it. They basically have to play around Spike Carapace. If that damage gets reflected, if there's no way they kill Nyx.
Epicenter and King R. Oh, he jukes to the north and avoids the rest of the Epicenter. And he's going to TP out, too? Oh, my God. These are sure kills that are actually just not going their way. Meanwhile, BZZ's been caught by Undershock. I don't think he has enough damage to get the kill.
Can he land Chemical this Rage, torrent?
He needed the Torrent or Arrow to go and bring him down in order to get caught there, but he's going to come back in, actually. Throw down an Acid Spray, but Undershock wants to take the rest of this away, and will do so.
Oh, he actually got a couple of the Mud Golems. It's not the worst ever. He's still farming quite fast. I mean, he's the highest net worth. The problem is that he's about equal to Anti-Mage, when you're playing Elk, you want to be way ahead. Oh, he's going to get a bounty, finally.
He should, anyway. I will.
And he's rich. Okay.
And
he could definitely die, though.
It's his armor.
Kunkka. They'll have Torrent follow up.
There's the arrow coming in. They don't even need the Torrent. They'll find the kill one way or the other.
Dude, even Anti-Mage was here. He's like, yeah, I'll just show up for the ulti here, just in case. That's effort, man.
Did he get the assists, or was he a part of that kill? I'm not sure.
I think he was a little too far away.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think you're correct in that. Charge coming out. That'll be from the Spiritbreaker Yul, who's heading towards Vin as they're looking for... I'll make Poshkar, whoever. There's going to be the X marks coming in with a torrent. Fate's Edict to dodge some of the magic damage, but the Impale is coming out. Yul shows up the perfect time. RMN, not dead yet. Still actually regenerating the Purifying Flames, keeping alive. And Undershock in trouble. Fortune's End, he'll leap away and actually avoid it. And Ghostic will walk out as well, but Undershock really wants his kill. No, he wants to TP instead. A great Duke, and he will survive. One more Purifying Flames might have done the job there. And that will be another bit of space creation as everyone rotates mid for F5 with the exception of Illidan. They will, however, find King Yara on the other side of the river. There's the Cold Feet.
Can this man get a bash?
He's got Chilling Touch. Really, he can't at all. This has to be a bash if he sees Ghostic. Which, by the way, he doesn't. Impale comes out on top of the Ice Vortex, which follows up with, of course, the Cold Feet, the Chilling Touch, the damage coming in from Ghostic. Another great kill from Empire, and just more fancy footwork that enables them to survive. And F5 to waste just so much time.
It's really fun to watch Empire play this game, actually. They're moving around very well. I do want to give a shout-out to RMN, though. Like, the way that he dealt with that Kunkku combo was perfect. Instant magic resistance and nuking yourself so that you get the heals afterwards. So the fact that he was able to stay alive there was pretty incredible.
He had some difficulties earlier, you could argue, with his Oracle finding kills, but that certainly was the right play when it came to surviving there, and that's important. Undershock will take down the Tier 1 tower mid, which is...
Check out the last hits right now. Look at those numbers.
Yeah, that's
there's
pretty...
four heroes that have 70 CS at 11 minutes. It's just, like, fucking incredible. And there's been tons of fighting, too. That's the weird part.
That is that's actually crazy. You're right. It's 11 minutes, 70 CS. It might not be the craziest thing for some people, but,
they're
like...
ready to kill AM. They might get him here.
This
close.
Is going to be a burrow strike. They have to go for it. He backed away. He could have walked forward. The AM wasn't going to blink, and now Ghost is coming in with Vendetta, and they want this kill. They won't get the Impale onto RMN, but the Star Storm, not enough. They get off the Fate's Edict, Crow Strike out, Mana Void, not there in time. Here comes a huge Ice Blast, bringing down that Sand King at the very least. Now Illidan getting torn it up, it looks like, and they're going to try to find Yul as well. Impale will fly. Illidan, false promise up from RMN, trying to save his teammate as best as possible. They want Yul, they'll find him. Can they get Illidan as well? Answer to that question seems to be no. We'll see if they go any further. Miposhka's got X marks, but swap back. He actually might kill himself for this. Illidan now out of mana. X marks again. Still rather tanky. Has a lot of armor. No mana void. To be able to get this kill, they need an impale, and it's on cooldown for another 5 seconds for Ghostic. And so he will run, and it looks like they will make it out. They did take down Undershock, which is maybe the most important thing in that fight for Fantastic Five. Also, the Alchemist continues to free farm along his merry way.
Crazy fights here. I really think F5 should have gone for the AM. I mean, it would have been a little difficult to kill him, but they had huge nuke damage, especially with four heroes, so didn't go for it. AM survives and ultimately gets more golden experience.
Oh, Yul. He should be okay, maybe? They have Mana Void in 5. He's got no charge. They missed the Impale. That's not going to be enough. Burrow Strike comes in onto Ghostic. No detection, however, as they are Moonlight Shadow. Afterlife needs to be careful. Swap back. Magic Missile Stun's going to hit. Should be out. He's going to blink away. Ice Blast is coming through. Fortune's End. Burrow Strike. Afterlife will fall. And he didn't have his Battle Fury either. They'll take down Yul. 1-for-1 exchange. Ghostic getting stunned by the Vengeful Spirit. Another Epicenter that's whipped completely by Always Want to Fly. They'll drop down the wire. The arrow's going to come through. Misses wide to the left. Always Want to Fly still. Cold feet it up. Not enough to actually stop him in his tracks and stun him. He'll make it out. Another 1-for-1 exchange. And again, though, while this is all happening, BZZ getting closer and closer to that Radiance.
Yeah, that fight was way better for F5 there. I like the swaps. Radiance the stun into swap on AM was really smart. Especially because it got him close to the team. I'm surprised Sand King was able to land the Burrow Strike to get the follow-up, but killing AM there was absolutely worth it. Like you said, BZZ's farming. He's farming about as fast as AM has been this whole time, except now he's hitting his swing, where he farms ultra-rapid due to Armlet, as well as Quelling on neutrals.
It'd be even better if he had Radiance, and he's getting there soon. He'll have the Relic to give him that damage, and then, of course, the Radiance recipe will come out shortly thereafter.
Yeah, he's behind. He should have it by now, Radiance. For Armlet Radiance, you can get it by, 13 minutes, but due to the amount of bounty runes that he lost, he's been behind.
Right. 14 minutes isn't necessarily a bad time, but you'd like to have... Oh, swap, Magic Missile, there it is again, Unstable Concoction, and the ultimate coming out from Yul will blow him away. And the AM decided to farming the top lane. They scout him out immediately and destroy him.
That was kind of dangerous play from him, actually. I think he showed on the lane and then went to the jungle as they started the charge, so they were able to get tons of information on him. That's basically a sick play by Yul to instantly charge him in case that happened. They get a free kill out of it.
Well, the courier will go down. Ghostic takes away.
That's pretty freaking
huge,
actually.
Let's see. I don't know what was on it.
That was a relic, dude.
Was it the relic?
That was a relic.
That's what I figured it was. I always want to fly in trouble. Bro strikes up to the top area of this map, but it looks like he will get away. The Impale, if he had known where he was TPing, he might have been able to hit it, but unfortunately not the case as they take down the top tier one tower.
I didn't even see how close the Ice Blast was in Fountain. It must have been close.
Yeah. I didn't even think about checking that. I thought it was going to survive either way.
The relic delay is still pretty huge, though. That's minimum 3 minutes for him to have his radiance. It's looking like it's going to delay by like a minute.
Yeah, because he already has 900 gold. Like, he just needs to farm a couple more creep camps. And actually, this creep camp probably should get him his relic gold. So yeah, it's going to delay him at least around 2 minutes. I think you're absolutely right. So that's a critical error. The bigger error is that Afterlife doesn't have his Battle Fury yet, and those two deaths have cost him so much. Instead of a 14-minute Battle Fury, which he should have had at this point, it's now going to be 16 to 17 minutes. Undershock swapped up. He's got enough mana to leap, but he's going to get Magic Missiled and destroyed by Forged of Zen and the rest of the nukes they have between him and Yul. That's a huge kill.
They are going to get a Sand King on the mid lane in the exchange, though. And that was Nyx Assassin initiating on that one, and eventually a fall for Kunkka. I really like what Illidan's doing this game, though. The fast hood pickup, very interesting. I mean, Venge is by far one of the most efficient carries in the early game in terms of stat points. She has amazing strength and agi gain. And by putting Dragonlance, Treads, Aqua Wand, she's amazing in early game with Venge and Sora on top of that. And then if you just buy a hood for like 1500 gold, all of a sudden you have 325 barrier block and tons of magic resistance. It's actually such a cool build. I like this a lot.
Did you see earlier on when they had two or three people hitting her in the bottom lane and she just walked through her tower? She even swapped a hero and stayed alive afterwards?
Yeah. I mean, that's Venge. She has really high armor at this point in the game. And putting the hood on this, I think this might be a new build, honestly. Like, this might actually start justifying Venge as an early game core. Because normally she gets to this point where she's like, well, I kind of feel like I have to buy a BKB. And then all of this advantage that she's gained from these inexpensive items that scale so well with her aura, she loses that value. But by buying a hood, you're only spending 1500, and it lets you be a really good battle carry. I really like this item build. Yeah, I think it'll work great.
The problem with battle carries is the amount of damage you pump out, but with Vengeance Aura maxed out like you talked about, you're getting 36% bonus damage. The Dragonlance helping out a fair bit along with the Aquila as well as the Treads. However, the Ice Blast is going to come through, but again, with the Hood of Defiance, it does no real damage, and they can continue to, you know, trade here, and in fact, they'll get the better end of the trade. They could even try to TP top to defend this, although it would be a dangerous play. Looks like we'll see both towers fall roughly at the same time. The Alk will get his Radiance now, 3 seconds from now. Hopefully it doesn't get killed by the Courier.
They're going to try to Rosh here. They can do this really fast, actually. They'll give it to Venge instead. She has way higher base damage.
Wave of Terror, although only level 1 Wave of Terror with the Acid Spray. This is going to fall very quickly with just these two heroes. Although the Ice Blast is coming through, it will scout this out.
Not going to matter.
I don't think BZZ can stay much longer because he is
sketchy. He shouldn't have turned off his armor. Why did he turn off his
armor? That is sketchy. He did not need to do that, but he will survive.
They might be late. They gotta kill this.
This is low. It's not done yet, however, as they're coming through. Miposhka, the ghost ship's coming in. They didn't finish as they hit the torrent. There's the ghost ship. The Aegis has been picked up by the Venge. It's already done, and now it looks like Empire need to leave. It's coming in the backside. Yul was thinking about charging. Unstable Concoction's already gone. Yul might be the one that's gonna be the martyr here for F5. He came in the wrong angle. Mana Void, he dodges it. Can he charge out? Yeah! Okay, now.
Nice Carapace there by Nyx to stop that. It's still a good trade. The Ice Blast made that really iffy because Alchemist backed out and got so low on his HP, so that was very scary, but they were able to finish it in time. Gold advantage from Rosh as well as having the Aegis is easily worth it, though, for one support like that.
So, BZZ, he got his Radiance, and he hasn't gotten much... Oh, he has Boots of Travel. Okay, I was going to say, if he had only gotten his Radiance and the Courier died and he hadn't gotten anything else, I was going to be very surprised. But in fact, he had gotten Boots of Travel. And there's a full pipe, by the way, done for the Vengeful Spirit, so it's just an early hood.
It's worth it. I really like this, honestly. Like, the amount of early game battle value this gives to your team just so much. Always want to flag it again. Wrecked in the jungle.
Oh my god.
Oh my gosh, he got blown up. I think Potamus had an invis or something like that.
She did. She had an invis there. The Ghostick's going to get caught. Spike Carapace nicely done again. There's going to be the magic missile. They have the detection here, and Ghostick should end up falling. Vendetta is going to hit Illidan. False Promise, though, and still has the Aegis. Torrent's coming through and slowing him down. So they'll stop the chase and any further kills that they're going to get on F5 side, but F5 are the ones turning around now in this game. They're looking very solid. And the ET Mage is just going to need more time to work with.
I just want to talk about this pipe for like 40 minutes. It's so good right now.
Go for it. You can keep talking about it, unless it only dies here.
It's too much. We'll see. He's got an Aegis. They're having trouble playing him once. He's still alive.
They have Mana Void. Not using it yet. He's plenty of mana left. Ice Blast is going to come through. Illidan should finally die for the first time, although Undershock needs to leap away to make sure he survives. Illidan! Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, they didn't have to AT up on time, but that's still pretty incredible what he's able to accomplish with just that one Aegis.
That's a lot of abilities.
He's got 1600 gold now from all of that. And his Wave of Terror is going to be maxed out. It's just going to get better. He'll probably go damage on himself. I think I'd like to see SNY, something like that. Something to increase his mobility and give him a little bit more stats.
I'm okay with an SMY or Manta, one of the two. Although you usually don't see Manta.
Awful.
Yeah, you don't see Manta. Yeah,
like,
don't do that.
His base damage is pretty good stat-wise, but I don't like Manta as a damage item. I think SNY is a lot stronger, especially because of the movement speed increase. It's like 6% extra.
I could actively see the disgust in your face when I mentioned that item. Yeah. You're like, holy god.
Dude, it's 5,000 gold and it does like... It's way worse damage-wise than Manta, unless your illusions stay alive. Or you're like an anti-mage or something.
Speaking of AM, Manta, not there yet. He does have his Vlad's and Band of Elven skin, so he's building towards it. I think F5, despite the awful, I wouldn't even call it awful early game. It was pretty bad. It wasn't awful.
It was respectable. Like, they kept almost getting kills, but they were getting outplayed. And they clearly played worse. I would use the word worse. They made some decent mistakes in terms of their trading and stuff, but it was close. Like, I wouldn't say they got absolutely stomped on. Sure. They had some issues, that's for sure.
Ghost ship to clear creep wave, that's always nice, but Illidan's coming in with level 2 swap. Unfortunately, not quite the range to get it as he walks out. Mipolishka's going to get away in time. I think, again, like you talked about, they barely missed out on a lot of these kills, and a lot of those kills they were missing out on, they're now getting, just with the help of Illidan, the help of pretty much everybody, except for the Alchemist, who's split pushing and just farming at this point in time. Radiance, he's got the majority of his Manta-style build, or at least the majority of the expensive components of his Manta-style build. We do see the fact that Ghostic is here, but he can't kill him solo. He needs help. But there's a smoke up from F5. They're going to head towards the mid lane. They have an arrow drawn.
Afterlife. Could find AM.
He's blinked into the tree line. They will find him. They had vision up on the high ground. Do they have detection? I think they do. And Dust will actually help finish him off as Illidan right clicks him down to death. He's now dead for a minute, by the way, with no buyback. It's not that big of a deal, but the minute death timer is very long for that Anti-Mage.
Yeah, I mean, Anti-Mage made a pretty big mistake by farming in his jungle, considering that F5 just had been in the safe lane. I would have thought he would have been in the off lane instead, but I do like what Mipolishka is doing, though. He's just constantly pushing out the creep waves. It doesn't cost much mana to throw both. But death happened. Oh, that was Alchemist.
Yeah, Alchemist does go down with the Impale coming out with the Starstorm and the Aghanim Scepter is more than enough to get the kill. There's a charge coming out, but Undershock's going to go ahead and TP away, and Ghostic will do the same, so the charge will then divert back towards the mid lane, and Yol will cancel it.
They didn't even have to use Arrow there. I'm surprised they were able to get that kill so easily, but yeah, the Alk is still a little delayed here. But either way, it's completely fine. Killing the Anti-Mage there is easily going to offset it. It's like not even close. F5 is way stronger right now.
There's still that Aghanim Scepter on the Mirana and the newly minted Blink Dagger, but that's not enough yet. Some Vision, Yol? That was close. Way closer than it looked, I think. It was pretty close already, but the push bottom now will halt for a moment as the creep wave is dead and Empire is on the hunt looking for targets to bring to their knees. But unfortunately, F5 are going to be able to escape. And they'll be able to make it out.
They can't fight for a while. They got to wait until they get Manta on Anti-Mage.
It is SNY, by the way, for Illidan. You were exactly right about his choice. He's got almost the full SNY done.
His courier transition actually kind of hurting him. He's only about 500 gold away from finishing the SNY.
Yeah, he could have waited. Not a big deal either way.
We'll see. It could be huge. It's a Ring of Health for Armin. Does that finish his item? Actually, it doesn't even finish his item. That was kind of... I don't think they... Oh, it's got wards. That's why. That makes sense. Okay, so they're setting up for the split push here. Charging towards the top lane. I am not sold. I mean, he doesn't know where that
is. They have vision.
But...
They have vision. They see Yol coming. They know that he's here. What a spike hair face and blink in front. Yol's dead now. Like, that is just really good vision. They'll know that there's going to be a ward somewhere along the way he charged, but that's a great kill still.
That was kind of a weird play by Yul there, definitely. I mean, I know they want to stop the split push and stuff, and he keeps being late, but by charging from the other side of the map, you're gonna catch a ward on the way over. That's pretty greedy.
There's the Essence Wine out done for the Illidan Vengeful Spirit. They have Nyx Assassin invised up and always want to fly nearby, but no sentries. In fact, the sentry there is going to be the Radiant Sentry. Arrow hits onto BZZ.
He's fine. He got his ulti off right before it hit. He saw it coming. It's a good reaction. If he doesn't get his ulti off, maybe he dies there. But once he gets Manta, things are going to be a lot easier for Alk. But really what he needs is he needs the tank item after his Manta stealth. And it's... I don't know what he's going to get, actually. I mean, he kind of has to be KB.
He's dead. The Ancient Apparition Ice Blast makes it a lot easier to get that kill.
Like, what do you do about that? How do you deal with that gank as Alchemist? All you can do is, like, not stand in creep waves. Like you just always have to expect two heroes nailing you for, like, an instant stun and a stun follow-up and an arrow and an ice blast. Like, you just die, unless you pop BKB in time with the gem or something. I just don't know how to deal with that.
That's the thing. He might have to get it eventually this game, but he's, again, like you said, he's again, he's an Alchemist, so he's going to have a net worth advantage, but it's not as much as he would like at this point in time. He could be further and further ahead. Even so, he's still pretty far ahead of an AM. Only has 14,000 net worth at this point. But also something I wanted to mention was the other item that's really important for this team is Kingar's Midas on the Ancient Apparition. He's got two components of his Aghanim Central already. Purge. That's pretty damn solid.
Yeah, he's doing really well. And Ags is amazing this game just because it will delay Alchemist's ultimate for so much longer. And same for Oracle ulti, actually, and Oracle heals. It's a really good game for Ags. I'm not always a huge proponent of AA Ags, but this is a great game for it.
We'll see if he can finish off that Aghanim Scepter here in the nearby future. Bots into the mid lane, and they're just going to go straight for this tier 2 tower. They're sick of getting split, pushed in. They want to take down another objective for themselves. There is a glyph available, and I imagine they will use it or not. It's just going to take the tower. They have to maybe save it for the tier 3 is maybe their intentions. Torrent narrowly off the mark. Illidan, it looked like he was going to get caught. He's going to get X marked for an arrow potentially coming in. No arrow, just the cold feet. He's pretty speedy, though. They won't be able to take him down. But the split push commences top lane, and that's where the Manta Illusions will go to work, and Illidan will try to clear these up. And he does a pretty good amount of damage to the Illusions. Like, a serious amount of damage. But Ghostik's on the hunt, looking for more F5 players, and I don't know who he's going to catch. In fact, I don't think they'll catch anyone, but should be the end of that.
He's still farming decently well on Alchemist. He's ahead, but once he gets Octarine Core, he's going to be sitting a lot better, because he's going to have an extra 450 HP, but I still don't know if that'll be enough to keep him alive in some of these engagements.
It's tough. We talked about that Ancient Apparition Ice Blast and like two heroes combining him to get kills and the Alchemist.
Yeah.
He really, it's kind of like, you have to make a couple of decisions. Can I be alone? You know, are we pushing? You know, am I going to have an Aegis? You know, it's a bunch of things that you have to worry about as the Alchemist. And luckily, Roshan is up in 22 seconds, which I do think favors them based on the map control that they have currently. Although, Empire getting more and more bold by the second as they're moving up to go again down in the bottom lane. Arrow, I think, is going to hit, but he's got Chemical Rage. And
I'm really just not sold on the items that Anti-Mage has just yet. They've definitely been delayed. Those two deaths, like you pointed out earlier, were a huge detriment to their team because he didn't get Manta as fast this game. And now they can kind of just control the map better. I mean, F5 clearly has better anti-mobility using charge, bench swap, stuff like that. I mean, Illidan's farming amazingly. He's 5-1 and 2 as well. He's got 3k gold in the bank. I think it's time for a damage item like Daedalus or MKB or something like that.
Daedalus would be cool. Well, they're going to find Undershock. Like and so Zeolator.
It's just so big. If every time they get a kill like that, and F5 is sometimes dying, and yeah, it's usually the Alchemist, but the reality is that if this game continues on this pace, eventually Alchemist will get insanely out of control. And then he's going to start buying Ags for people. Like, look at Illidan right now. What if he gets a free Ags on top of that? He dies and he comes back and he does half damage. Like, that's amazing.
He's missing the extra stats and all that jazz. Bukowski's getting out of his ghost ship. That will not save him. He'll try to TP out. Oh my god, is it? Are you kidding? The three-man torrent and he actually survives by TPing? That never is supposed to happen.
What the hell?
Oh, Alchemist almost died to that. Okay.
They had a sentry on the ground. They saw it coming. You can see the cursor coming into target, but they just gotta make sure they don't get split pushed. I think that's the only way F5 loses this game, unless things get crazy late game, that they just get split pushed.
Oh, always wanna fly, about to get mana voided, and there it is, Afterlife, in fact, squashes the bud using that magic. I don't know what it is, honestly. Man avoids something. He hates magic, but he has it for his ultimate, I guess. Armin's getting pushed back into the base, and if he had mana void again, he'd go for it, but it doesn't quite work like Axe's.
You know what? You know what doesn't make sense about Anti-Mage? Like, if you really hate magic users, I'm gonna do this later. I'm ready though.
I mean, I'm about to get angry. You should hold on, because if the Alchemist is gonna die here, BZZ is dead instantly.
All right, it's time. You know what's messed up about Anti-Mage? The fact that his ultimate only does damage after the mages that he's supposedly killing are low on their mana. It's like, okay, why wouldn't you just make a spell that like works good when they're strong at magic? Instead, he's like, no, they're gonna be strong magic, but then they have to be tired and I have to drain their mana, and then it does a lot.
He's kind of arrogant about it. He's like, I've drained their spell power with my mana burn. Now I will kill you, dastardly.
Yeah, and who
spell
made his,
users?
Who made his fancy little Psyblade things that drain mana? Probably some magician. This guy's just a freaking hypocrite. Anyways,
I mean, he's like a kid that was like raised up on, like, he was a kid that was raised on, like, some sort of, like, comic book hero type of, like, story. But
really?
Later realizes he's, like, a hypocrite or something. I don't know.
Oh, really? Yeah, I don't know.
I'm guessing. If we want to know the real lore, we have to ask Slax.
We need Slax. Yeah, too bad Slax isn't here.
Yeah. You gotta save that over for a Slax and Purge cast, then you'll be really good.
I really did. He might have given me some good stuff there. Maybe he had a point to put me
on. Sorry, I'm not Slax Purge. I don't know what you want me to tell you.
What's that about it?
Fuck. You know, I can't be everything.
Dude, A is 3-0-7 right now.
Yeah, he's
like actually wrecking.
I wish he had his eggs already. He had.
Who cares, dude?
He has not died this game. I felt like he could have farmed a bit faster, but maybe that's just.
Yeah, it's a little slow. But you got to remember that F5 has been positioning really aggressively. They've basically controlled Empire's jungle, and Empire's basically controlled F5's jungle. So I think that's why we're seeing pretty low farm levels on the supports.
All around, this has been a pretty fun game to watch. You know, just the thing, like the movement of the teams, kind of the chess match when it comes to positioning, split pushing, things like that. Speaking of positioning, Illidan goes underneath the tier 3 tower to dive Vipozhka, and is successful.
Oh, he's going butterfly, actually. That's a cool build. Should make him very survivable against Anti-Mage if he gets going on. He's going to pipe and a butterfly. How does he die?
It's not going to be easy, I'll tell you that much. He's already got a lot of armor as it stands right now.
Oh no, he's gonna get stunned. This is actually a huge opportunity for them.
Ghostix should go for an impale, and he will. Illidan does have the Aegis. He's gonna get false promised, and he'll go back to work on hitting the towers after doing that much damage. Unfortunately, the arrow's gonna come through. Hit a creep. That should be it. Illidan will get healed up to roughly half health. The ice blast will sail through, and it's gonna be too late. The trail will hit two of them, but
Empire is like not paying attention. That was like the biggest gimme I've ever seen. That he walked back in with ice. Cold feet on him, and he got stunned for 4 seconds. Like, what the hell? They easily should have gone on that. I mean, he's got Aegis, I guess, but maybe they don't want to ulti that, but
I think that's
I just feel like
that was the biggest reason why is the Aegis, or I mean, I don't know. I feel like there was an opportunity there, but
he's got eggs now.
Who does? Oh, the AI. Gotcha. Okay. Well, that's gonna be a good man style from Afterlife. Gosh. That was pretty sick. And Mana Void, no, not needed. Doesn't need it. Just get the kill either way. And they're not done yet. They're looking for more. Undershock, Yule Scepter. They've got the arrow on. Always want to fly. Burrow Strike, not very far away. And he's gonna get Mana Voided. And again, squashed like a bug as Devil Kill comes out for Afterlife. Another Unstable Concoction. That was by BZZ. They were chasing him down, but he's able to get away mid as their smoke has been used and popped. And they're looking to find him over at the Ancient Stack, but they are gonna be sour. They realize that he's not actually there.
He's having a lot of trouble on Elk. Like, his farm level is equal to Anti-Mage now. It's so bad. Like, he should have Octarine Core Manta at, like, probably 25 minutes. He's very behind where he normally would be.
You know,
They have great ganking heroes, though, like we said. It's just so tough for him to stay alive if they do put all of their effort into him.
It feels like this game could really go either way at this point. It's just so close, I think. And net worth-wise, it's the same as well. It's 1,000 with advantage for Empire. The experience advantage might be the thing that tips it over the edge. It's a 12,000 experience advantage going for Empire, whereas the levels for a lot of your cores for F5 are very similar, as the AM is 21, and that's really where a lot of the experience factor is coming in.
Most of that really changes, though, once you win a team fight. If F5 can take a fight and they can go like 5-4 or something, they're going to get most of that experience advantage back. That kind of thing swings even harder than Goldgrass do. It's going to help for heroes like Spiritbreaker mainly, but right now he's just got no points in Greater Bash. Actually, like his skill build this game, considering how weak he's been. It's really just important that he's able to chain stun and affect his team's movement speed in a nice way with Empowering Haste.
It's not something you see very often. You often see the Greater Bash maxed out, usually.
Well, like I said, he's behind. He's not really relying on his damage. He's not trying to scale. He's trying to make sure that his team is useful. So it's kind of like he has a really nice drum of endurance by maxing out Empowering Haste. I actually think some teams should do this more often, where you max out Empowering Haste. It's 18% movement speed with 4 skill points. Like, that's really fast. That's faster than an SNY for every hero.
Oh, no. If he pops it here, they'll be very speedy with a...
Yeah, then it adds an extra 9. Like, it's insane. It's so fast.
Somebody
like
might be 5-2-2 or something. Always want to fly as 5-2-2 with tranquils.
Oh, they didn't scout it, though.
They did not scout it yet,
no.
It's
a talisman. This could be pretty big if they can kill us. He can one-shot it almost for sure.
They can see it, I think, here. He's going to even use his butterfly flutter. Yep, that's it. It's gone. Killed. So the talisman is now... It was a talisman, right?
Butterfly AM. Yeah. That'll delay his B-fly. They can try to Rax here, maybe. I don't know if it's a good idea, though. With BKB, Vlad's Eagle Song, he's still pretty survivable on AM.
They're going to go for it, it looks like. They're going to head up to the high ground right now. Not the best tower sieging yet. They have illusions to come through and do some work here. They're just trying to
stop Mantum might be good.
They're actually trying to stop Blinks, I think, with these Radiance illusions. It's actually really cool.
This is so scary for Elk here. He's got to worry about the...
Ooh, Spike Air Pace. They're going to jump in and Pale onto two. Here comes the Ghost Ship. Illidan's still okay. Ice by Sailing and Yule will take the Ghost Ship damage. That'll be it. Arrow comes in, misses as the swap comes out from Illidan. Now there's going to be the Nether Strike. I mean, Pushka. Magic Missile comes out. Force is dead. Force is forward, but dies at the end. Now with Burrow Strike coming in, but Understruck, he had the Lincoln Sphere that blocked it, actually takes down the Sankey. Illidan will get the last right click, but now the Cold Fiend coming out. He's slow. And Pale misses. He's going to walk away, or maybe... As Undershock moves forward, Unstable Concoction! Can they bring him down? Yes, that's the gem on the deck. And Illidan won't drop anything yet. Can he bring down the Nyx? No, he's too speedy. Ice Blast point blank from King R. They double impale. They're so low, they just need one more. And they cannot fight it. Here comes Undershock back in. False Promise is up. They'll try to heal him, but it's a long duration Ice Blast. He's frostbitten forever. He should still fall here. And finally will, just at the tail end. At the telltale end of that, X Marks comes out, they got him. They'll bring back RMN, and he'll get caught. Fates Edict will not keep him alive for much longer. Although he is making a lot of space, he's
dude,
got
he's
no
so
TP.
Frickin' ownage. It's actually incredible. RMN is like playing this game so perfect. Does get killed there in the end, but that was his first death. We're 36 minutes in. Look at the heroes he's against, and he's only died one time. They almost won that whole game, though. Like, if False Promise could have lasted just long enough, the AI Ice Blast would have ended, Illidan would have been healed, and they could have kept fighting and saved a couple of heroes. But
where
they also did get Raxed.
AM. Oh, that he was getting Raxed, by the way. Should have pointed
probably
that out.
The butterfly. And that's why Illidan stuck around and tried so hard to get the range barracks, because he wanted to make sure that he would get an equal trade, but they didn't even get that, and they still lost heroes. They could lose the game now. If they lose this Rax, it's basically over.
15 seconds left. I don't think they want to buy back on these two heroes. They may have to. There's no glyph up and ready. Afterlife will get stunned. Here comes another Ice Blast. It'll go nicely dodge. However, Yol will get hit by an arrow and torrents and blown away by Ghostic. Vendetta. Epicenter coming out. They're going to try to go for King R first, but he gets forced out nicely. Afterlife BKB is now up and ready to go. It's a 10 second, I believe, or 9. Still going to work. And now BKB comes out from BCC as well. Try to heal up with that on. Stable, or rather the Chemical Rage, and now it's off cooldown, or on cooldown, excuse me, won't be able to heal up much more, and he's actually getting kited so well, and always want to fly Ghost for a blind bro, but everyone dissipates so damn quickly for Empire that they lose essentially nothing out of all of that.
Yeah. They really, I think the swap kind of messed things up. They separated the Anti-Mage a little bit too much from the other heroes. The Sand King got a Cold Feet at the same time. If they would have stunned him there, he would have died, and they could have gotten the AM kill, but they lost it. They needed that advantage a little. They didn't, like, lose towers, but that was an SB buyback. It's just getting worse and worse. They're not quite hitting their fights perfectly.
That's kind of what was happening in the first 5 minutes of the game, where they were missing out on kills left and right, where they should have gotten them.
Yeah, definitely agree.
And it's the same sort of situation now, and Empire just seems to have a way out in almost a lot of these situations. And a way to find these kills, too. X Marks, Torrent, Arrow, all of this lockdown, and really... There's one or two BKBs, in fact. I think it's just the one for them on the Dire side right now, which is understandable. But Roche is going to have to be your point of contention, I think, if you're at 5. You can't give this away. You can see them heading over in that direction now. You can see also that Ghostic and Afterlife are nearby. They've picked up a DD for the Anti-Mage, which is maybe one of the best ruins given the situation. However, we'll see if they do take a fight.
I think Illidan's in a really good spot now. Boots of Travel SNY with Butterfly Movement Speed. He goes 522. Does tons of damage. Backed up by his team as well with a pipe. It's looking really good. for F5. Although, okay, smoke does break. They know that they're in the area.
Ward is placed down, but they don't have vision of the pit, obviously. They'll see Undershuck, they'll see the Ice Blast coming through, and now they go right on to Illidan. He's already at half health, and he's got the Frostbitten debuff on him. The Ghost Ship will hit, he will almost certainly fall here, and there it is. Afterlife getting the kill, and he wants more. BZZ, good Yule Scepter coming out to stop him from chasing any further. It's on the Sand King, but the Sand King will end up giving his life away just to try to save the Alchemist. And that almost feels like game at this point. They have no buyback in Illidan. That's the biggest issue here. Afterlife will go straight for the tier 3. And again, Fantastic Five. It always seems so close, but so far for them in a lot of these situations. And they're going to lose a tier 3 and Rax. Actually, there is no creep wave here. That's the biggest issue. So instead, Afterlife will be aggressive. Although the unstable concoction, Mana Void blows up one. Almost blows up the second. The X marks will bring it back. And, GG is called. There it is. They know that if they're getting dove in the base, they have no respawns or no buybacks, that'll be the end of the game. And so, Empire, they persevere. And they're able to take the game, Purge.
Man, I feel bad. Like, F5's strategy was so interesting. It's just they really missed the mark on a couple of their characters. Their offlane completely flopped at all stages of the game, basically, except for a couple ganks. Like, Sand King just got nothing done. He had a terrible KDA, 0-9-6. The Spearbreaker was 1-11-9. But in terms of RMN and Illidan, they absolutely own this game. And BZZ played fairly well, but some teamwork issues in the early game led to him not getting bounty runes, and everything was kind of delayed. So I feel like if the game just went a little bit better for Alchemist this game, or if one of the other stunning heroes, Espy or Sand King, if they just had a good game, I think they easily could have won this. It's just everybody in Empire played so much more concise from the beginning to the end.
I absolutely think that's correct. And Fantastic Five are a mistake or two away from winning these games. In fact, all three of these games, the games against Escape and this game against Empire, it just comes down to one or two of those little ganks that, if they were successful, then, you know, they get more of an advantage for themselves and they keep things going. Very close in this game. BZZ obviously with an okay performance, but it could have been better in terms of the gold that he acquired throughout the game. Illidan, good in theory early on in the game, but he didn't have enough of the tank later on. And King R, if you have a deathless ancient apparition, that's probably where it all goes wrong, Purge.
Yeah, it's one of many issues that happened, but mostly just really solid performance across the board for Team Empire compared to some great performances and some really iffy ones on Fantastic Five. So that's pretty clear game one win.
Yep. So with that, we'll take a break. Game two right around the corner, guys, here for WCA 2016. We'll see you guys in just a moment for the next game.
Think you know esports? Then prove it. Win real money on all your favorite esports games. Just pick your event. We have loads to choose from. And place your bet. Win real money at Betway.